So thanks for the invite to speak here. And it's really nice speaking towards the end because I got to hear most of the other papers. And I think I'm maybe going to be a little more positive than some of the other speakers about digitally managed centers. I feel everybody's pain because I experience that kind of on a daily basis. So it's not that I don't have those same experiences. But and I also thought, wow, you know, I was at University of Maryland at the beginning of MITH, Maryland Institute for Technology and the Humanities, in the early 2000s. And I thought I was there at the beginning of the digitally managed centers. But who was it? Maciek said there was one in 1978. What was 1978? Who had one in 78? Yeah. So maybe I'm not so old as I thought. And it was modeled on University of Virginia, which I thought also was one of the first ones, but maybe not. And it's great to see so many digitally managed centers, so many types of centers, so many institutions flourishing all over Europe. And they share a lot of things with those early digital humanities centers. But I'm going to talk about something in depth that was alluded to quite a number of times by people. And it goes under different names: public engagement, participatory engagement, social engagement, things like that. And I will argue that digital humanities centers are the ideal entity to foster those embracive, outward-looking, participatory cultures, even more so than individual projects. And I believe firmly now that centers should have, as part of their staff, somebody with that skill set to foster that engagement across projects in the way that institutes now have metadata experts, IT experts, if they can hire them, who work across many, many projects. So some of you may be familiar with this term. I'll tell you that it is not public relations. There's similarities in the modalities, but it's a very different component. And I'd also say that having aspects of projects, and this has been mentioned over the last couple of days, projects of social relevance is not a nice add-on to our research. It needs to be thought of as a key component of it, that it's no longer an option for us in the humanities to do our research, even if that research is web-based so people can get to it, and be in conversation only with our peers. And I'm going to argue that creating projects of social relevance, reaching out to the public, to schools, to teachers, to the retired, to all those with the skills and talents or people interested in developing those skills to contribute to our scholarship, to enrich their lives, is a necessity, not just a nice add-on to what we think our real work is as academics. So I've been involved in two projects of social relevance over the last few years, both center on the Easter Rising of 1916, and I'll tell you that they have been the most rewarding intellectually, socially, and methodologically that I've been engaged with. And they have been lots of fun. I won't say that there aren't problems, but they're really very different in terms of engagement. And I'm going to thank you in advance for allowing me to tell you about them. So the Letters of 1916, I began in 2013 as a social engagement project. That was one of its major goals. The second one, I began a year earlier, Contested Memories, this Battle of Mount Street Bridge project. It was a kind of conventional, unconventional digital humanities project using 3D technologies. And very recently, over the past year, we've recrafted it for use in secondary schools. And that's the part I'll talk about. So my colleague, Kathleen Fitzpatrick, she's associate director and director of scholarly communications at the Modern Language Association. Her latest project is called Generous Thinking, the University and the Public Good. And we've been in conversation because both of us are working in very serious areas. What is key to the quote that I have up here is the word conversation, that public engagement is in conversation with individuals as opposed to, say, something like public relations, PR, that is directed at individuals. This is also in contradiction to crowdsourcing, which has been caught on really widely in digital humanities, cultural heritage in the past few years, and that I'm also going to talk about. So what is crowdsourcing? It's been around. I'm sure most of you have heard of it. This is not an atypical definition. Most of them focus on the public doing work for us that would have been traditionally done by staff, members of staff. And most definitions of crowdsourcing frame participation in terms of what the public can do for my project, as opposed to why the public might choose to spend their creative capital on my research project. So in 2006, a report came out in the States confronting the challenges of participatory culture, media education for the 21st century. And Henry Jenkins identified three motivating forces for why people participate: a relatively low barrier to artistic or civic expression, strong support for creating and sharing one's creations, and some type of information mentorship, whereby what's known by the most experienced members, either of the community or project team, have some way of mentoring people who are coming into the project, and they feel some kind of connection with one another. And I would say that not many of our digital humanities projects, outward facing, because most of them are, they're on the web, the people get into them, embrace these three aspects. So there was an interesting conversation a few months ago, actually a long time ago, in the summer I think it was, about crowdsourcing on the text encoding initiative list. And we began with one person asking for information on successful crowdsourcing projects. And the thread morphed really quickly into, and I'm quoting, crowdsourcing transcription failures, with one respondent positing that scholarly projects can expect immediate or quick success. And the person continued, and I quote, "If we expect to do the equivalent of barn raising in digital humanities, where a large number of people come together and do a lot of tedious work quickly, we'll have to expect a lot of mopping up to do afterwards. And we're limited by our level of patience and how far we want to go to train people to mark texts in thoughtful, observant, well-informed ways." And I'll say that my experience of social engagement in our digital humanities projects have really been the opposite. So I have a lot of problems with this quote and the assumptions. And I highlighted my problems in red. And my questions are, why should we ask the public to do tedious work? If someone feels an activity like text encoding is tedious, maybe that's not the right field. The expectation here is the public's going to do whatever work is required so that the professionals, we're going to have to mop it up later. And lastly, that working with the public will test the patience of professionals, and we can't have an expectation that the public will collaborate with us in thoughtful, observant, or well-informed ways. And I think with assumptions like this, one could not build a project where the public would come and stay. Sometimes it's easy to get them to come. It's really hard to get them to stay. So I'm going to argue that we shouldn't be thinking of these projects in terms of crowdsourcing as a way to get cheap labor for our projects, because in fact it isn't cheap at all. You just spend your money differently. So in 2009, there was an article by Rose Holly, and she made the distinction between social engagement projects and crowdsourcing. In her definition, social engagement wasn't central, but exists at the margins of project goals. It provides the means for the public to engage with the content beyond reading or viewing, so maybe tagging, providing other kinds of things. But she used the term crowdsourcing as a more integrative, more collaborative, more participatory approach. But I think the problem with these definitions is they seek to create a dichotomy between the public and the project. They frame the public participation in terms of work accomplished, like transcribing newspapers or annotating images. So I would like to redefine social engagement within DH in terms of more participation. So for me, social engagement involves the co-creation of the archive with members of the public, giving and both receiving, that people can give things, maybe in terms of archives. They might give documents, they might give their expertise, they might give their time. Social engagement provides a vehicle for the contributor community to interact with team members as well as each other. Some of this may be asynchronously, and I'm going to show you something about that later. I think in social engagement projects facilitate exchange. Members of the public may make things available, knowledge available, while others benefit from them. And social engagement projects don't just ask the public to work to achieve project goals, but facilitate their own contributor goals. What might they be? Maybe enjoyment, educational, discovery, making new connections, feeling wanted, feeling important, feeling central. Relating to space, maybe this project has to do where I live now or where my family came from, or time. In my lifetime and my parents' and my grandparents' lifetime. Public participation isn't a new concept. GLAMs and subject experts have used multiple channels for reaching out. But the model of engagement of the activities on this slide is the premise of the idea that professionals design the experience and the public learn from it. And these activities, while useful, don't take into consideration recent research that demonstrate when learners can learn directly, it affects the learning process. It affects their understanding of content or the outcomes of their experience. And the higher their motivation, the more impact their learning has. So why do this now? So what Sharkey has defined here is something called the cognitive surplus. It's a profound change in our expectations as consumers, particularly of culture. This participatory culture isn't new. Prior to the rise of television, virtually all culture was participatory. You made your own culture. After the Second World War, as more and more societies, certainly in the West, became affluent, we sat in front of TVs and culture was beamed to us. But the internet has changed all that. Now business has shown us how much people will give their capital to things like things that will make money for companies. And I think we are missing something very big if we don't design to capture people's time and energy and creativity. There was a recent article by Gregory Jay, and he speculates that public scholarship and community engagement will become central to revitalizing the humanities in the 21st century. Efforts to connect humanities research and teaching projects with projects to advance things like democracy, social justice, and the public good might take advantage of this latest crisis in the humanities and represent, he feels, a new direction for revival. He feels that the future of the humanities depends on two interrelated innovations: the organized implementation of project-based learning and scholarship, and the continued advancement of digital and new media learning and scholarship. And these projects that I'm talking about, we'll speak about that today, and maybe, unless he's totally wrong, I suspect that digital humanities, whether it's going to be a discipline or migrate into the existing disciplines, is here to stay. So both the projects I'm going to talk about today have at their center the Easter Rising of 1916, probably the most important event in Irish history. For those of you not from Ireland, this seems to be an all-Ireland panel. On the 24th of April, 1916, Easter Monday, a small group of Irish called Volunteers rebelled against British rule and changed the course, certainly, of British and Irish history. It took only a week for the British to put down the rising. Very unpopular while it was happening. A lot of Dublin city center was destroyed. A lot of the poor lived in the city center. A lot of them had relations serving in the First World War. The executions beginning about 10 days later, over a 10-day period began the 3rd of May, brought about a real shift in public opinion, made martyrs of the executed leaders, and set in motion a series of events that eventually Ireland gets independence from the United Kingdom. So despite the execution of the leaders, despite about 500 deaths, over 50% of them civilian, the destruction of Dublin city center, about 3,500 Irishmen incarcerated in prisoners of war camp in the UK, the Rising is viewed positively, the beginning of the birth of a nation after some 800 years of British rule. So the letters of 1916 had a fairly central role in this centenary commemorative process. And what it brought forward was a very unique perspective, personal perspective of letters, the epistolatory form, and how that change and challenges established history. So the overarching goal of the project is to revise the narrative of the period through a project of social relevance that would break down the barriers between the public and academic research. And we did this by collecting letters for a one-year period, 6 months before and after the Rising, as long as they're about Ireland, very widely conceived. And it was designed from the beginning as a project of inclusion, and how we collected letters, how the letters are transcribed, how they're encoded in all our outreach activities, and in who is considered Irish. We also had as a central tenet that we wanted to provide opportunities for non-traditional audiences to learn about the technologies we used. So letters were particularly chosen. There are two wars during this period. There are letters about the everyday. There are letters about war. There are letters that are significant in total in organizing and shaping lives. So we also designed the project as something where individuals could take a meaningful role in uncovering what had been a, by and large, silent history. And one of our taglines was, be part of the research project. And one contributor summed this up nicely. He comes from a Methodist background. He said, I found it very moving that Uncle Wesley's letter had been accepted as genuine and a valued fragment of Ireland's history. It was almost as if I had been accepted as Irish for the first time. So there has been a lot of speculation. We've all heard it. Some people talking about it today has the capacity to make the humanities more relevant in this crisis in the humanities. But I would argue that technology itself can't do this, no matter how superbly crafted our projects are that we put on the web. I would say that to reach a much wider audience than traditional publication, even traditional digital publication, we need to build our projects for engagement, not as an afterthought. We never thought, and this is one of the problems I have with that word crowdsourcing, that engaging the public was going to provide cheap labor for us. In fact, I'd argue the opposite. Running a project like this is more complex, more time-consuming than just sending work out for, in my case, transcription. These projects are phased in very different way from more traditional digital humanities project. And we keep launching the project. We do this because we keep wanting to get attraction for it, to get more people to transcribe, get more letters. So the public are co-creators in this from day one, which means that a lot of my team energy goes into reaching out, nourishing, and retaining community participation. The project also challenges what we might call passive memory at the time with an active engagement. So one of the reasons I wanted particularly people to transcribe is that it's very different for all of those of you who do transcription, much different transcribing someone's words than reading them. And what I wanted people to do was really get into the mind, into the headsets of individuals at this time, whether they might agree or not with their political perspective. And in fact, this is what happened. We've had complaints, particularly from school kids, that they can't read the handwriting because I think nobody writes anymore. But even that has been very interesting for them to realize that these things exist, letters exist, and that people communicated in this way, which is very hard for a lot of the kids we work with to imagine. So one of the messages was, this project is for you. Without you, we can't do this project. We say this to institutions. We now have 32 participating institutions, and we have, I think, 54 personal collections that have been contributed. And we also went to schools after we were up and running. One of the early promises of the web was that we could combine resources that either has been geographically dispersed in archives, or even bring them together, in our case, from private sources. And that, by and large, hasn't happened, mostly because I think institutions have their own imperatives to put their materials on their own site. But we did work very hard, and it worked very well, in asking institutions to forgo that to create an archive where the sum would be greater than the whole. But then I had, with so many aspects of this project, a kind of epiphany. I had this kind of JFK moment. And I realized it was not simply about what institutions could do for my project, but what my project could do for institutions. And what we found are that these very small institutions around Ireland began depositing letters, and we got in touch with them. And this is, if you can read it, it's very small up there, one of the quotes from the Jesuit archive. This was part of a brochure we created when we launched. And we asked, you know, why he was uploading the letters. He said, you know, we have no web presence. And this makes it possible for us to participate in the centenary commemorations. So community engagement, some quotes. I think that as a technology project, we designed it for inclusion, for empowering people to participate. And people responded in kind. This is a really interesting visualization. If you can see it, the red dot in the middle represents one of our earliest collections. It's a collection by Mary Martin. She was a nurse during the First World War, and we have a lot of letters from her. And so all the larger nodes, the red nodes, the yellow is her, the red nodes are transcribers. And the little black clusters are letters, pages of letters. And we found out that there were 43 different people who collaborated on this. Because people can transcribe, people can retranscribe, they can encode, they can change things, they can edit. And so it was interesting, we found how we did some studies on this, how the community collaborate together, but maybe don't even know about it, this kind of asynchronous collaboration. A lot of people. My team is getting smaller now that 1916 is kind of coming to an end, but we're going to see about continuing. Really good learning opportunities for students, both our students in university and we work in secondary schools. We created with teachers lesson plans with teachers twice, two summers, and once with the military archives. And one of the main goals was how do you use primary sources and technology. Another goal was to promote IT literacy in schools. And someone mentioned earlier that, you know, kids may be good on Facebook or whatever they're on, but they're not very good with technology or understanding what goes on behind the scenes. We did a more in-depth workshop with secondary school students and got really very positive, very interesting feedback from them. This is just a little infographic that we produce every year to kind of show the progress of where we've been. So very quickly, I'm just going to go on. Oh, and one of the things about projects like these, and of course ours were within this very important year in Ireland, that they do capture the public imagination. So there was a major documentary or a major TV event, radio documentaries on the projects as well. So the other one I'm going to talk about really quickly is, I mentioned this Contested Memories, Mount Street Bridge, 3D virtual world. But what we did is recreated for secondary school audiences. And we've just really begun, we've done some focus groups, but now we're starting doing testing. So what we've done is picked out five groups, and we designed it for a particular year in Ireland called Transition Year, where there's a little more flexibility in the curriculum. We want to increase the technical literacy of the teachers and the students, to provide students to work as a team and to create an interactive experience for them to explore the past. So we use augmented reality. We've taken some of our 3D, we've printed some of them out as buildings, and we've developed what's called a handling box that will get shipped out to schools for about a 2-week period where they can do these lessons. We created videos, there's game playing, there's a strong narrative thread, and what we chose were what we call the interactions where there's no right answer. We don't even know the right answer as historians. And this goes directly against a lot of the teaching in schools where they learn to what the right answer is for the exam. So it's a little distressing that we don't give them the right answer. And I like to think of something like that as an example of Fitzpatrick's generous thinking of reaching out to students and teachers to share our knowledge and expertise, which enriches both their and our scholarship and learning. So one of the things I'd like to close with, some of you know, how many of you know about Daria Teach? Lots of people. How many of you watch videos? Oh, a couple people. So this is another kind of outreach activity. And I would argue that some of these, they can be done as projects, but I think doing them within the a kind of center environment allows greater economies of scale, as it were. And I was just going to play one. One of these, maybe. Oops.
Oh. Digital humanities for me is a means to bridge art.
Oh, sorry about that.
Research and social issues. I'm very interested in how we can find ways to bring forward the past and draw from the past to make it meaningful in the present. And that means reaching across different fields and using the tools of our time to create a kind of liaison to speak to the past and to let the past resonate with us. And by doing that, I mean to let the different forms of expression live forward, those of performance, of writing, of making images, of telling stories, of addressing the, in the sense of political conditions of our time and the social conditions through these forms, these lessons we have from the past.
Humanities for me includes the social sciences, the hard sciences, the arts, really in kind of a Renaissance way of trying to understand what and how the human experience is shaped and how we can use digital technologies to ask new questions in new ways through new methodologies and new practices.
I would define it as humanities disciplines with digital tools. And I would qualify that by saying that the tools we use provoke and produce the thoughts we have in relation to our discipline. So I guess I would see it as a conversation, digital humanities, a conversation between humanities disciplines, whatever your discipline might be, mine happens to be English studies, and the tools that I am bringing to that discipline at different points.
Digital humanities is many things, I guess. It's a lot of what people dream about the humanities, and they think that the digital part will be the realization of this dream. And sometimes these people might think the dream could turn into a nightmare. They might be afraid that the digital part of the DH might swallow the humanities part. But hopefully this is less and less the case. People realize that DH, digital humanities, is just means to further, to go beyond in humanities research. And probably in a few years, we won't even think of DH as something separate from the humanities. We will just use digital methods in the humanities, hopefully.
Digital humanities is the application of quantitative methods to pre-existing problems identified in humanities disciplines and to the possible generation of new ones. There is a form of genius, of course, that's unleashed by digital humanities, and that gives us hope for the future. But I rather think that the substance of the questions that digital humanities offers us new methods of answering, that substance will remain disciplinary. So I see it more as a meeting of disciplines rather than a discipline in itself.
So I showed that because this is our attempt in Daria Teach to help answer those questions when people ask you that awful question, you know, what is digital humanities? What is it that you do? It's for students. It's for the public. It's to show funders. It's to show your administrators. Again, it's a reaching out. So I'm going to close by saying participatory engagement is not just methodological, it's a philosophic approach. They're reactive to the community, they're responsive, they do shift much more. They're about teams, they're about community. And so I think my takeaway is that these projects shouldn't be thought of as a means to an end, but an end in itself. Contributors should be clear as to what they're participating and what they're going to do. As a role for centers, again, as I said at the beginning, I feel really strongly now that centers should think about having someone who can do this kind of work on their project team, because while it's great for one project, it's very transferable skills, if we could use that word, that can be used across many projects to mentor people in those ways of thinking and building into their projects, building into their grants, this mode of work. And so I think it also localizes that word that a lot of administrators like, impact, and those kinds of strategies to make these projects work. And these are all the people who funded my projects. Thanks very much.